I'm Ari Bernstein. I'm the interim director at the Center for Climate Health and the Global Environment at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. We call ourselves Harvard Sea Change for short. And I'm a pediatrician at Boston Children's. I've been teaching on climate change and health now for a while through a course offered at Harvard called Human Health and Global Environmental Change, and more recently through a massive open online course through the Harvard X platform called The Health Effects of Climate Change. I really appreciate both the teachers and the students who are engaged here and your willingness to grapple with this subject. A lot of people don't want to talk about COVID and the environment, but the truth is that we can have all the ventilators in the world, all the hand sanitizer. We can even do a lot to do surveillance so that we detect things earlier. But if we really want to prevent the emergence of diseases like coronavirus, we have to be thinking about how we deal with nature and how we deal with the climate. So coronavirus, and in specific COVID-19, is an RNA virus, meaning that its genome is encoded in RNA. The COVID virus is a member of this group of viruses known as coronaviruses. And coronaviruses are nothing new per se. There are coronaviruses that have been circulating in people and causing respiratory illnesses for a long time. But what we've seen more recently is that these coronaviruses have been spilling over. That's the term that is used to describe the movement of a pathogen like a virus from an animal into a person. We've been seeing coronaviruses spilling over from bats, which are their animal reservoirs, into people more often recently. We had SARS, which is the severe acute respiratory syndrome. We've had MERS, which is the Middle East respiratory syndrome, and now COVID-19. And each of these is a coronavirus which wasn't a bat and got into people. Coronavirus might not immediately seem connected to climate change, and I think it's fair to say that coronavirus could have happened without any climate change at all. So we strongly suspect that coronavirus COVID-19 got into people from bats. That's because we've studied bats and found lots of coronaviruses in them, and there's a history of coronaviruses moving from bats to people. And we know that in other diseases that have spilled over from bats to the people, that the disturbance of forest habitats has made bats come into contact with people and led to spillover of disease. For instance, Ebola in West Africa, there's been transmission ongoing as bats have had their forest homes either disturbed or outright destroyed, which pushes them into greater contact with people. Similar story with Nipah virus, which is a virus that first emerged in Malaysia in 1998, where bats came to get food at a huge pig farm. And there were mango trees grown around the pigs, and they came and ate the food there. And so we see a recurrent pattern of deforestation pushing on bats, which may increase risk of spread. Climate change, of course, is also pushing species to move in places they haven't before. That can create new contacts between species. Whether any of those forces directly influence COVID, I don't know. But it is absolutely the case that climate change can drive disease emergence, and that while on balance it might be hard to see with some diseases like malaria, where the climate is probably getting better for malaria in some places, like higher up on mountainsides and maybe towards the poles. It may also be getting less suitable to climate for malaria in places it's been a long time because it's too hot. For zoonotic diseases like COVID, by pushing, animals and plants to move to the poles and up mountainsides, there's certainly an upside risk there. I think in the issue of COVID, it's a little unclear. And then we can go one step further downstream with the connection between climate and COVID, which is what we ask people to do about it to protect themselves. And hand washing is a big part of that. And, water supplies in large parts of the world are not great. A billion or more people may not have access to sanitation. And that makes hand washing really challenging. Now, there are many reasons there's not a lot of water around. We've been using too much. In many parts of the world, but climate change has increased risks of drought, and severe drought, which doesn't make that problem easier. So you can see that there are touch points between climate change and COVID sort of across the range from spillover from animals to the people, and then all the way down to what we do about it. Air pollution clearly matters. We have research now in Italy and the United States showing that people who have breathed polluted air for years, so this is not, you know, changes month to month, this is their where they've lived, the air quality over many years, that places with worse air quality are places where people are more likely to die. And that's accounting for other factors that may contribute to people's likelihood of dying from disease, like pre-existing medical conditions, poverty, access to healthcare, and so forth. And that's not news, frankly. We have research from lots of other respiratory infections, including viral infections like influenza, that air pollution can increase risks of dying and also can potentially increase risks of disease transmission. So when it comes to health, health problems amplify inequities in societies. And that is when it comes to infectious diseases like COVID, or even, you know, epidemics that are not infectious like obesity. These problems tend to affect the people who are poorest in societies first. And therefore, when we address those problems, they have major effects on addressing health inequities. So with COVID, we know that people in the United States who were, you know, less well off economically are the ones who are least able to protect themselves first. So they're working in jobs that required them to be exposed. They're more likely to suffer economically from the disease, losing their jobs, losing livelihoods. That's bad for health. They may be less able to access healthcare because they've lost job and don't have insurance. And these patterns are true regardless of where you are in the world, that the least well off in our societies are sort of harmed. But there's another dimension to it, which is that poverty and pollution always are associated. So regardless of what country you're in, people who are less well off are exposed to more pollution. And that's because people are willing to pay more to not be exposed to waste sites or, you know, the smoke from smokestacks and power plants and so forth. And so, you know, in the United States, we have a history of injustice towards minorities that has prevented them from getting access to wealth, which means they're more likely to be less economically well off, meaning they're more likely to live next to roads, next to power plants, next to energy infrastructure that's polluting, and therefore more burdened by disease. And as I mentioned, we have evidence with coronavirus that people who've lived with more exposure to air pollution are more likely to die. And so we see again with either the obesity or COVID pandemics that these amplify the injustice and inequities in our societies. And so it's extremely important to address those points, because those kinds of inequities are the ones that are not just bad for the people who are less well off. They wind up being less, they make all of us less well off. And COVID is a really clear example where, you know, if people are at greater risk and they're less able to care for themselves and they're, you know, spreading this disease, none of us was immune from this virus. And so that puts everyone at risk. But I think the more important connections are between relate to how solutions that we need to put in place for preventing things like COVID are really aligned with what we need to do for climate. The clearest example of that is deforestation, as I mentioned before. You know, deforestation drives disease emergence, not just of coronavirus, but of lots of other diseases like malaria and other mosquito-borne diseases. And of course, deforestation is responsible for a large proportion of greenhouse gas emissions. We need to address underlying health problems. We know that the disease affects people with pre-existing medical conditions. That means that if you have a population that's healthier baseline, they're going to have less problems when COVID comes or other diseases. You look at the major driver of underlying medical conditions in the United States, it's obesity. And obesity is driven by a lack of access to exercise and unhealthy diets. If we get people eating more nutritious plant-based foods and less processed meats and red meats, we will address obesity and we will address carbon emissions because, of course, meats have much higher carbon emissions than plants. If we get people onto public transit and walking and bicycling to work or school, they're going to be exercising more instead of sitting in cars. And then, of course, if we burn fossil fuels in cars for electricity, that makes air pollution, that's bad for COVID. Moving to renewable energy, wind, solar, and like enables less air pollution and, of course, less carbon. And there are other ways in which the solution spaces are aligned. And so I think whether we're talking about where the problem comes from or what we need to do to fix it, there are connections. But the most important ones really underscore that a lot of the things we need to do for climate are exactly the things we need to do to protect ourselves from diseases like COVID. So a little bit depends upon where you are in the world. I mean, there's some parts in the world where people live where, you know, chopping down and destruction of forests where these diseases are living is a big problem. And in those places, I think it's enormously important to raise awareness to the reality that while people do benefit when these forests are chopped down and burnt, those people are relatively few and the benefits are very short-lived. But the harms of doing that are large, and we see that now, whether it's the burning of the Amazon for raising cattle or the burning of forests in Malaysia or Indonesia for palm oil plantations, that the air pollution from those burning can kill huge numbers of people, and short of that can cause real harm to people, make them miss work, get sick, get pneumonias, et cetera. And so I think there's a real importance for people who are younger to help older folks recognize that these actions are self-destructive, that they look like they're doing something good for people in the near term, which is true, but the bigger picture is that they're a path to nowhere. And so we need to figure out how to get the health value of what's going on into the conversation about how best to use these resources. I think for students who are in countries where, for example, are not in the tropics, I think there's a couple things. One is, you know, we need to recognize that, and I'll use the United States as an example, that we can do a lot to not only improve our own response to this, to epidemics by investing in public health and making sure that we have the resources in place to deal with a epidemic infection like this, and that's true both in places like the United States and places elsewhere, but that we can use resources to help do better surveillance of animals in the wild to make sure that, example, the bats, we understand where the viruses are and we understand where they may encounter people and help support efforts that would prevent the spillover of pathogens into people. We also can deal with the reality that the United States is one of the biggest consumers of wildlife in the world, and that creates a huge potential flow of pathogens through our country, and also, of course, puts people at risk overseas who are going into wilderness to try and capture these things and potentially expose themselves in the process. And ultimately, particularly in richer countries like the United States, we have an immense responsibility to deal with the root causes of climate change, whether that's investing in projects that prevent deforestation or addressing the carbon footprint of our country. And that's because, so on one hand, climate change, as we talked about, has real implications for our ability to deal with this kind of problem. We have the hand washing issue or the effects that it can have on any number of the foundations of society, access to water being one of them, but food and other, you know, underpinnings of health. But also, of course, because of the air pollution effects and how we know that air pollution is such an important part of respiratory diseases. But the list goes on and on. And I think a key point for any student who's engaging in this is to recognize that, one, you may, in fact, find yourself better educated about many of these subjects than many people who are older than you pretty quickly. Two, the connecting the relationship between health And the environment is critical because, as obvious as it may seem to you, it isn't necessarily that obvious to others. And three, please don't be quiet. Make sure that your understanding of connections between health and the environment, that you've done your homework, that you understand them in as much detail as you can. And then, you know, write about it, talk to people, make sure that if you see people misrepresenting relationships, as is often done, that there's a voice there to counter that.